Welcome to Talk Back. I'm Ishar Aluwalia. Today we will be discussing the impact of the WTO on legal services in the Indian economy. To discuss these issues with me, I have Mr. Harish Salve, Solicitor General of India, and Mr. Shardul Shroff, Senior Partner of Amarchand Mangaldas. Welcome. Lawyers have been very much in the news, and there is this concern in lawyers' minds that in the WTO, if India takes up the question of opening up of legal services, all hell will break loose, that we will have all kinds of lawyers coming in, taking away jobs of Indian lawyers. Would you care to comment on that, Mr. Sanjay?
Oh yes, I think most of the fears are imaginary, because we have not even waited to define what exactly are the requirements of the WTO where it comes to this. I do not, first of all, see any impact on the average legal professional. I do not think there is any proposal which would have foreign lawyers flooding our law courts. And I think 80 to 90% of the profession still is in the litigation field. The only area where we have to consider is not even cross-border trade, because if anybody wants to consult Indian law firms, or if any Indians want to consult foreign law firms, they can do even today. There is no restriction. The only area where this will operate is allowing foreign law firms to come and set up base in India. Now, as long as you have to be an Indian citizen and an Indian lawyer to practice in India, I don't really see, and I don't think there is going to be any dilution of this principle, then one really has to see where and how this at all has to be worked. So I don't think there's any cause for concern.
Basically, what you are saying is that in order to practice in our court, we don't envisage foreigners coming in and practicing law in our courts here.
Unless they allow us to go and practice in their courts, which I don't see happening.
Yes. So we are really talking about legal advice on matters such as taxation, intellectual property.
No, legal advice again is practice of law. Either practice of law is demonopolized, which is not the proposal anywhere in the world. You have to be a lawyer to practice law. Giving legal advice is practice of law. An Indian lawyer who gives advice on Indian law, if he sets up base in New York, they have a very pejorative, I consider it a pejorative expression for him. They call him a paralegal.
I see.
Correct?
I see.
So if an Indian lawyer cannot give advice on Indian law in New York, I don't see how an American can be allowed to come into India and give an advice on American law.
But let me ask you, Shardul, since we are actually getting a lot of foreign investment now into the economy, so foreigners who are not familiar with our laws are coming into our country. They need advice on project finance. They need advice on taxation matters. Right now, who do they go to? And under the WTO regime, if we were to open up, how will this change?
I think what has happened in the Indian profession is that all these majors, international majors as law firms, have set up what they call India desks. And they have regular arrangements with domestic Indian firms, which are in the legal services field as what they consider to be legal services. In their perspective, legal services is not the litigating branch of the law, but the kind of management for multinational transactions, multi-country transactions, large deals like project finance transactions, setting up mega corps in India. It is that which they consider to be legal services. And that's a sliver of the practice, really. But that sliver is, in terms of remunerative practice, perhaps much more remunerative than the litigation field. So it is that area of the practice which the foreign firms is really targeting. And that is, I think, the perspective which they're really trying to push and open.
But would it be fair to say that about 80% of our lawyers must be practicing in the courts? So they would not really be affected, or maybe even more, not be affected by all this?
I don't think that is totally true, for this reason, that ultimately it is the transactional work which goes into litigation. So if the major, if 80% of the transactional work of some magnitude and some seriousness is captured in a sense in the smaller firms of the West, then it is they who will control the major litigation in relation to those transactions. And today that is factually happening. If you see the project finance documentation or the major foreign venture documentation, most of the litigation has been exported because they are all subjected to foreign arbitration. So you have already lost, in a sense, the jurisdiction from India.
But you know, on the other hand, one complaint that one hears in India is that you have a few family firms. You know, there is closed partnership in law firms which really caters to all these kinds of issues, and they are the only ones who will come in conflict.
Not entirely uncalled for, but monopolies of all kinds are bad. Family monopolies are bad. Economic concentrations are worse. I have seen documents in the power field, I wouldn't like to name them. One of the Haryana Electricity Board was consulting me at one stage, and a document which I saw and the kind of money they had to pay for getting that agreement made was appalling. And I asked him, why did you pay this kind of money for this kind of a document where your in-house lawyer could have done a better job? And his answer was shocking. Mm-hmm. He says, if you have to go to this group of financial institutions, you have to go to that law firm. Now, isn't that a monopoly? So let us be very careful. When we say we are going to allow foreign firms to set up base, we welcome talent. Import any kind of talent you want. We are willing to face up to any kind of talent challenge. But let us not import this kind of cartelization.
No, I agree with you, absolutely. But I have a question for you. If we want a consultancy firm to be set up in India, where you have lawyers, accountants, and you know, people from different professions coming in, providing an overall consultancy to a client, would that not lead to more export possibilities of services?
Let me answer that straight away. Who could give better advice about Indian law than an Indian lawyer? Any good law firm outside, any good big company outside knows who are the top law firms in India, who knows who are the top lawyers in India. Their services are always available. Please use them. Mm-hmm. Why must you insist that if you, Mr. Shardul Shroff, if you, Mr. Thakkar, if you, Mr. Radhachandji, have to work for us, please change your name from Shroff and Company and become a satellite of Shadburn and Park. Then we will consult you.
No, clearly, I think nobody would like that. But what I have a question for you is, that goes like this, that don't you think that we can turn our companies into multinationals? Because if we are really proud of our knowledge base and we have all this talent in the country, why are we afraid to take on the competition?
We are not. Will they allow us to practice in their countries?
But that is what the WTO will ensure. See, whatever arrangement, Shardul, whatever arrangement we come to, whatever government agrees on the WTO would be on a reciprocal basis. They are allowed to come in, we are allowed to go there.
Reciprocity will not open markets. What Harish clearly mentioned is the reality, that there is a informal cartelization, the clubbing theory, which is in practice today. You are seeing it in the accounting world, where the big five have, in a sense, captured all the major accounting transactional
work. That's because there is no agreement. If you enter into an agreement...
Even with the agreement, this structure will not change, because the kind of deep-rooted links that these major organizations have, as Harish did mention, that, you see, there are informal associations where a banker is associated with a particular law firm. If you have that particular financial transaction rooted to a particular set of financials, they will go to only a particular set of lawyers. So those kind of principles which happen, but on a larger plane, when you say that Indians will be allowed to compete with the multinationals, the two major realities which need to be considered are, where is the capital for an Indian service firm to set up a multinational corporation?
Let me also...
Human capital.
Let me add a sentence here.
Human capital is not enough.
Mm-hmm. Let me add a sentence here. There is one, again, a very peculiar feature of the legal trade. It is totally human-oriented.
Exactly.
We have faced a problem. Please run through the list of the International Chamber of Commerce list of arbitrators. Our judges and our jurists are no less than any of the foreign judges and jurists. How many of them are picked up by the International Chamber of Commerce in Paris and appointed as chairman of tribunal? Mm-hmm. I have not heard of a single.
It's a white man's club.
Let us first break these barriers. You are talking now of a trade which involves interaction in human beings. Mm-hmm. It's not supply of goods. It's not selling butter. It's not selling oil. It is accepting a human being and willing to work with him one-to-one basis. Let the attitudes change. Why are my colleagues in India up in arms? You can't make us feel that we are inferior lot and then say open us.
But tell me, the IT sector, you know, in India, the way it is received all over the world, why is it that in software we don't have this problem? Why is this peculiarly relevant for legal services?
Let me venture an answer. There is a great degree of replicability in the IT sector. The creativity element is one aspect of IT, and the second aspect is really the ability to recreate that same intellectual property, which is not true of the legal service profession. It is individual transaction to transaction.
Yeah, I think they would disagree with you, Shardul, because what they would say is they also make a product.
But there's no assembly line concept in law.
I would give it a more if I may say so, a more psychological answer. When you go to a lawyer, huge projects in line, you're asking him what to do, you have to accept his word. If you're going to have this feeling that does this chap really know what he's talking about, if that is going to be your attitude, that's where the whole thing breaks.
What you're saying is there is a certain psychological barrier that has to be broken.
Yes.
The personal
but
relation.
At the same time, I think there are examples of other industries who have gone through this transition and they've now come up winners. But we will come back to that after this short break. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to this edition of Talkback. This evening we have as our guest...
Welcome back. We continue our discussion on legal services. As I was mentioning earlier on, that there are other industries which have faced similar outcries when liberalization has come to their doorstep. And the particular one that comes to mind is the pharmaceutical sector. 10 years ago, when the new intellectual property rights regime was there for all to see, the Indian firms were very jittery and very apprehensive whether they'd be able to take on the competition of the large cartels of the world. But today, you have to admit that they have come out on top, doing very well. So, can we not say the same about our legal strength?
I think the reality is different because you compare 2-3 facts. We have hardly 3 or 4 firms fulfilling the 20-person norm maximum size of a firm. You have limitations which England gave up way back in the 70s, still applying in 2000. To Indian firms.
But can we, do you think they should be liberalized?
They should be. We have made a suggestion in the amendment of the Companies Act, but I don't know whether that is coming out in the present current session.
We also have to gear up to this challenge. Our firms have to be allowed to expand. I mean, let's borrow an expression from the pharmaceutical industry. Let's create first a level playing field. Mm-hmm. So, we have a silly archaic old law which said you cannot have more than 20 partners. This law was meant to hit large bubble firms which were doing business, not meant to contain professionals. So we have to allow our law firms to grow to that strength.
What is stopping the government from doing that?
No, I'm sure all this is in the under consideration. Supreme Court is hearing a case where the larger issue has come up. The Delhi Bar Council, for example, recently issued malpractice notices to lawyers who were listed in the Martindale U-Bell, and somebody has gone to court against the Bar Council saying that it's correct to say that the profession should not be allowed to advertise, but the notions of advertisement have to keep pace with contemporary times. Giving information in a international directory such as Martindale U-Bell is not advertisement. Mm-hmm. If we want our lawyers to be global, he must have a website. Now, to have a website is not just to propagate his cause, but is to impart information. Notions have changed, ideas have changed, media has changed. These old rules will require a relook. When that is done, when we have a transition, I for one, not for a minute ever fear that on our intellectual caliber, we can take on the best. The point is our lawyers are functioning with one arm tied behind their back. You can't ask them to go to battle in that frame.
Yeah. Shardul, you were saying that this is one constraint.
See, the second issue is that there is no transition planning. Take the case of the pharmaceutical industry. From 1991, with the liberalization commencing, at what point of time was 100% permitted in that sector? You have had a full 9 years planning. Now, in contrast, what you're proposing is let foreign firms set up a 100% entity at day one without enabling the Indian law firms or the Indian legal practice to really firm itself up. If you take Singapore, for example, they put in limitations on law firms saying that you will not employ local talent for the fear that their dollar was so strong that they could have bought out the very employees who were working with the domestic firms. They were restrained on practicing local law. Now, I'm not saying that those may be relevant today, but there was a transition planning which enabled indigenous firms to survive.
Let me
ask you one question. Would you not say that 10 years is a long time in this fast-changing world? What you could talk about as a reasonable time in 1991 with that technology is very different from the time when we talk of websites today.
Let's look at it. I agree. Let's look at it qualitatively. Let's not look at it quantitatively, yes. 9 years or 5 years.
Right.
Let's break it down into its elements. You gave a very interesting example of the pharmaceutical industry. In a pharmaceutical industry, what was the Indian required to do? Why did we open our borders? Because we want the Indian consumer to get the finest available benefit of research. And if that research benefit can percolate to the Indian consumer only by allowing a foreign manufacturer to come into India, so be it. It involves employment of capital which is not available locally, therefore allow the man to come in. Now what are we talking about when we call of opening our borders? Let's break it down into its elements, and you will find it's not all that pleasant. Today, the same set of lawyers are acceptable to you. The label has to be changed. That is what you're talking about in allowing foreign practice in India. They do not mind Shardul Shroff and his 100 partners doing all their work as long as he changes his name. This is qualitatively different.
But I don't think that, to be fair, I'll tell you what. If we entered into any such arrangement at the WTO services negotiations, there will have to be reciprocal uniform standards for one thing. And one of the problems in our country has been that we really have the elitist legal education for very few, and you find most of these few firms that you're talking about are firms who have gone and got degrees from outside. Whereas by and large, we really don't have standards for people.
This is the whole point. To be a lawyer practicing in India, you have to be well-versed in Indian laws. If you have to be well-versed in Indian laws, means you must have experience of working in India.
No, but do you take an exam to be a member of the Bar Council?
Exactly. Of course.
A standardized exam?
It's a standardized exam for that particular batch. In the sense, what happens is there's an exam. It's a written exam. You used to have an apprenticeship principle over and above that. But it is an exam which the local bars conduct, or the solicitors.
Please tell me, how do you become a member of the New York Bar?
By an exam. You take
a New York Bar exam. A New York lawyer cannot practice in Washington.
Why are they worried about
practicing in India? Can he practice in Washington?
No,
he cannot.
Let us say one thing, that when we discuss this, everything is reciprocal.
When
we say they come here, you go there.
What do you mean by they come here? Now let us break this down into its elements.
If you open the export of legal services in the WTO negotiations, saying that our lawyers can provide legal service to outsiders in whatever way you like.
That's what I'm telling you.
Cross-border supply or whatever.
Please
other
tell options. Me a second trade in which you find this peculiarity. A medicine to address diabetes is the same whether you are a human being living in Geneva, whether you are a human being living in Lucknow. Your physiology is the same.
But the laws
of the two countries are different.
No, but if you have an investor coming in,
certainly
the project finance issues, taxation issues, as the corporate world is shrinking.
His taxation issues, where India will depend on Indian tax law.
But all the better. then the, in any case he will come to an Indian lawyer. So therefore, then where is the problem?
That's my whole point. Therefore, what, let us first define what we mean by saying allow foreign law firms to practice in India.
No, I'm saying you open up legal services, so you have both way flows. It doesn't mean that it will actually happen.
I'm sorry.
Why are Indian lawyers afraid that they will lose business? This is my question.
No, I'll tell you why.
I think they will lose business. My fear is not that they will lose business, but that they will lose an indigenous firm. You will be in a sense acting as a Western company's associate or
Let us analyze this.
That will be the reality.
Can we analyze this in terms of the four heads of the WTO?
Yes.
What are the four areas where restrictions are impermissible? Mm-hmm. Let's break it down in those terms. Cross-border trade of services.
It happens
today. It's permitted today also. Mm-hmm. Anybody who wants to consult a foreign firm, even an Indian if he wants, he's welcome to
do it.
Yes.
Somebody is silly enough to go and consult a French firm on Indian tax law, he's welcome.
Yeah.
The second is import of personnel. No country permits and would sensibly permit import of personnel, and that is where that's the point which I was on. There is no other area of service where what you have is peculiar to you. Mm-hmm. Your laws are peculiar to your country. Flying an aircraft in the airspace is not peculiar to your country. Acting as a doctor is not really peculiar to your country.
But then you shouldn't be worried.
No, I'll tell you the
why. Then the business is yours.
Therefore, what are we talking?
The market will work in your favor.
So therefore, what are we talking about bringing in? Now, let me tell you what we are afraid of. Mm-hmm. What we are afraid of is today you have an industry. They have a law firm in New York. That law firm doesn't want to let go. Mm-hmm. So what he says is, these very Indian lawyers must group up
and be my
and practice agent. Under my name and remit a part of their fees to me. And then this firm I will send there. So really what they want is, they have a monopoly or a quasi-monopoly in their country. Mm-hmm. They want to export that monopoly.
But let me ask you a question. We already have foreign accountancy firms in our country. And as I understand from many of my lawyer friends, a lot of what you would regard as legal service business has already gone out of the hands of the few into these accountancy firms. Now, so the question is, if something is happening, how do you prepare yourself to really come out better?
I don't agree with the perception that the major legal work, which is the critical legal work, has moved to the accounting firms. Yes, there has been, for example, in corporations, the issues which are more replicable and marginal have moved. The tax practice was always in India with a majority of the accounting firms. So that has remained there. But in terms of advisory services, where the critical, you know, litigation issues or the critical strategy issues on law are still with the major law firm.
See, we have to, I agree with you that with borders opening, if I was an Indian wanting to set up a business in France or in Germany, I would always carry with me my own doctor and my own lawyer. Mm-hmm. So if my doctor was available to me or my lawyer was available to me in Germany, I'd be a lot more comfortable. Yeah. Equally, a German coming and setting up here, if he has a German law firm or somebody who's familiar, he would be more comfortable, and therefore we have to open up.
Maybe he's more sensible and he would want to use local lawyers, in which case we create employment opportunities.
No, absolutely. Now, therefore, what we have to do, and this is what the government is in dialogue, and we have clarified more than once, there was a general fear created that the Advocates Act is being amended and anybody who's a lawyer anywhere can come and set shop in India, and we said nothing of the sort. Mm-hmm. What we have to find out is what, therefore, precisely do we mean by opening up legal services? It's a very vague expression.
Yes.
What do we mean? What are the parameters of opening up? Does it mean that a person who has done the New York bar can come and set up a law firm in Delhi? No.
Not unless we explicitly agree that we will be allowed to.
Which is not going to happen.
Which is not going to happen.
Because how supposing he comes to misconduct? Where will he be disciplined?
Now,
in any case, it will have to be reciprocal if we take it.
And reciprocity, in fact, seems to be disappearing in whatever little area it was. Mm-hmm. So, what else do we mean by opening up legal services? Then what we mean is, and perhaps that's the little area of adjustment, that foreign firms will be allowed to associate with Indian firms.
Create joint ventures.
On some kind of a restrictive basis, that if we send you our client, then you must sort of not take on a competing client. Mm-hmm. If we send you Coke, please make sure you don't take Pepsi on too and create problems for us. Some such arrangements our system will have to accept. Mm-hmm. Beyond this, I don't know what the meaning of opening up legal services would be, because there are
there are two ways. Are Indian lawyers going to be practicing in India, or are people who are not Indian lawyers being in India? I don't see the second happening. If it is only going to be Indian lawyers who are going to be in effect practicing in India, then it is all a question of what, how we marry our existing legal profession with the global scenario.
So there are many more issues, yes. Isha. For example, how do you control the misconduct jurisdiction when you talk of a non-resident lawyer setting up shop? He can export himself back, and how do you control him? One, two, issues in relation to professional liability. Supposing, for example, he gives wrong advice, then for an Indian client to pursue him in a non-resident jurisdiction is difficult.
More than anything else, there are more.
But Shadu, surely if this thing is done at a multilateral trade level, then there would be
There will be an association issue.
Yeah.
Conceptually, why is there a monopoly in lawyers in India practicing law? Mm. Why can't you, who possibly knows more tax, or we have so many eminent economists who know lot more tax than lot of lawyers. Mm. Can they advise on taxation? They cannot. Mm. Why? Why is law the monopoly of the legal profession? Mm. It is because the cardinal philosophy is, and that's true for all countries, that you have to be trained and educated in the laws to practice law.
Now, let me ask you one final question, which is that, is lawyering in our comparative advantage? If the world were free to trade in legal services, would we be able to say that we have comparative advantage in exporting legal services? One word.
Answer is yes.
Mm-hmm. I have one qualification. Remove the bias against the color of...
More psychological.
No, it's reality.
It's very reality.
Well, so we have to really prepare.
Our costs are one-third or one-fourth of their costs. Mm-hmm. On a cost-comparative principle, there is no way that any multilateral or multinational firm can really compete with us. But it's the access to the client and the access to that cartel which is where the problem is.
Thank you. We will be back the same day, same time next week to discuss more on the WTO and its impact on the Indian economy. Thank you.